So on any Porsche 911, can I just upgrade my turbo and expect to see more power?
911 covers a lot of years and a lot of differences. And I'd love to say yes, but what we ran into there is computers. And the early cars, 930 turbo, 3 liter, 3.3 liter, those cars, yeah, you can upgrade the turbo because there's no computer there to fight you. The 930 turbo is very common to upgrade those to a K27 or later onto a K29, K29 grosser turbo, they called it. Massive compressor housing on those things. Some people even went to Garrett turbos, GT3076, GT35, and you can do that without changing anything else and make a nice little improvement. Most people put 1 bar, 1.2 bar boost springs in them and, you know, fuelers and exhaust upgrades also, but really wasn't necessary. But you step forward a generation or so, 964 turbo, still CIS, you can get away with it. 993 turbo, you start getting first generation of the Motronics, and those things had diagnostics. The diagnostics would measure the airflow at a specific RPM and a specific throttle opening, and if the airflow fell out of a certain range, the computer would flag an error. So you'd change the turbos from the stock K16s, or if you were lucky enough to have a 993 Turbo S and have the K24s on there, and if you upgraded those without tuning it or without doing anything else, the ECU would flag an error. My memory, it's like a P1140, I think. I'll have to look that one up, so somebody can call me out there. Anyway, same thing exists. Move forward, 996 Turbo. Same thing, probably the same diagnostic code, 997 turbo, change the turbos only. Those are way worse with the VGTs. They're gonna get all kinds of upset because they're very particular about their boost control, having electronic actuators on the VGT vanes.
Thought I'd show you a little something everybody that asks a lot about. We pin the cams on 997.1 turbos, and I'm gonna show you why. This particular car, we just finished a pretty fun build, 700 horsepower E85 twin turbo, Zona rotor turbos from Tile on it. Everything was going great. First test drive, ripping the tires loose, second gear, no problems, lots of fun. Go through a quick shift, and then all of a sudden the throttle goes to hell. It just felt terrible. Sound was off, pitch was off, just didn't feel right. I'm like, oh crap, it's the deaded cam error on this car. Well, sure enough, I came back, plugged in Durometric, and here we go. Watch the blue line. The blue line is the actual bank 2 value. The two right there in the middle, those are the nominal values, and the other one's bank 1. You'll see blue is not doing what it's supposed to. You can see all the other ones are very quickly moving up and down. That one's very slow to follow. This is up at full operating temperature. Now, depending on where this thing lands, when the sleeve slips, it could get jammed full clockwise, full counterclockwise. This one just happens to slip a little bit where all it's doing is restricting the hull. And because of the restricted hull, it's making the fluid move slowly. With the fluid moving slowly, the cam is simply not responding how it would. Now you're saying, why is this still working? Normally when I get a cam error, mine goes to zero and nothing happens. Well, to visualize the error better, I've rewritten the code to knock the camshaft diagnostics out so the ECU is oblivious to this. It doesn't know what's going on. It still thinks everything's okay. Otherwise, it would have flagged P0012, P0016, P0020. There's a whole bunch of cam errors that pop up on these things, depending on what it senses at the time. Sometimes it'll even tell you a reference mark sensor is bad. But as you can see, bank 2 is clearly not doing what it should. The other actual and nominal are following each other very well.
Same thing on 991s, 991.2s, 992s. They're all going to require tuning with a turbocharger. Otherwise, you're extremely limited on the turbo changes, or you'll change it and see absolutely no difference. Because it may even be that the computers are so smart that it'll say, hey, we've got more airflow. We need to back the boost down. Like, uh-oh. So we need to keep it within these parameters. So you're going to put a bigger turbo on there and end up, the ECU is just going to fight you and just turn it right back down again. I always start with tuning. Of course, I love to tune these cars. I've been doing it for years, and I tune cars all around the world. So that's where I'm going to start, because any mod you do on these cars is going to require tuning to operate properly. You put the exhaust on, you change the intercoolers, you change the turbochargers, you put a different throttle body on. If you don't tune the car is going to get upset, and it's going to fight you. There were some diagnostic port tuners that people were putting on for a while, or piggyback systems. And what people kept running into with these cars is they'd try to turn the boost up on it, and the ECU would see that, and it would turn it back down. Or they would make it slightly richer, or change the timing. The ECU would see that, and it would fight them and turn it back down. So they might make good power numbers on the dyno. The guy would take it out on the street, and he'd bring it back and say, something's wrong with my car. The car's right back to stock power again. Because the ECUs were so smart that they would always turn the power back down to where they should be. The ECUs are extremely adaptable because Porsche develops world cars, and we've been able to take advantage of that because they see anywhere from super low octane to super high octane, from very cold conditions to very hot and high altitudes to low altitudes, and these cars have to be able to adapt into all these different conditions. And if you go and change hardware, the ECU just thinks it might be in the Sahara Desert, or it might think it's up on the high hills of Colorado or something, and that the parameters have changed and it needs to adjust them accordingly, rather than, hey, we just got a big turbo on there, we need to make all kinds of horsepower. No, they're trying to keep within the parameters that Porsche put forth in tuning these ECUs originally. So no, my answer is start with tuning. That's always going to be your best bet, and typically your biggest bang for the buck. And that tuning will follow through with any and all mods that you put on the car, and will follow through with you. Our tuning package starts out with a bass tune and recals. So you start with a tune, you throw some turbos at it later, we tune it, no charge. You go ahead and you upgrade the injectors, we tune it, no charge. Because it's included in the base package. Of course, we did have to limit the number of recals because that can't go on forever. I think that'd put us under. But we do give you a very nice package with the base. And then you get beyond the base recals, there's a recal fee that gives you another block to continue to move forwards with your mods. People just love to mod their Porsches. They have a lot of fun.
So besides tuning, is there anything that I can do to optimize the rest of my turbo system to take full advantage of the turbo I already have?
Oh, absolutely. I can think of two perfect examples. One was a 78 turbo, believe it or not, in California that the customer had brought to us. And I forget why. He didn't want to change the turbocharger. But he did want the car to be more responsive, more drivable, more torquey, more power. I mean, our customers don't ask for much. So on this car, we pulled out the recirc bypass valve. We built him a long neck intercooler. We actually left the stock intercooler on there too. Stock intercooler, stock turbocharger, just modified the intercooler for a long neck. We put a larger intake on it, routed the stock one comes up very small. So we put a larger air intake on it, a larger filter on it. We revised the ignition distributor. We clamped down the advance mechanism to limit the swing of the advance to force it to have more advanced more of the time. That gave the drivability a huge boost and improvement. I believe we put either a Euro exhaust on it, which gets rid of a lot of exhaust back pressure, and probably shim the wastegate or put a one bar spring in it. And these mods were actually amazing because, believe it or not, that little 3LDZ turbocharger that comes on that car can make about 400 horsepower. And everybody always used to take those things off because, oh, that's a terrible turbo. It's a stock turbo. It's not going to make much horsepower. The car only made 286 stock. So 286 to 400 is a huge upgrade. But everybody immediately thought the only way to, or the only path to more turbo, the only path to more power would be start with a bigger turbo. So everybody throws K27s, K29s, GT35s at the cars. When really, the stock fuel system runs out at 400 horsepower anyway. So to get beyond that was a major leap. So why not work within it? The stock fuel system ran out there, the turbo ran out there, fuel pump probably ran out there. Everything kind of ran out at the same place. So we just optimized everything to work within the parameters of that turbocharger. We did another one also on a 996 turbo, believe it or not. His wife called me, wanted me to keep it a secret. Don't tell my husband, I'm buying a gift for him for his 996 turbo for a Christmas present. And she asked me, what would we do on his car? I have X budget on this car. And her budget knocked turbos out of it right away. But that didn't stop us from still making a huge improvement on the car. We took that car, I believe we did fender well intakes, we did a set of our intercoolers, we put our Y-pipe on it, a 74 millimeter throttle body, and one of our plenums on there. So we upgraded the entire intake path from air filter all the way to the manifold. We also, I think on that one, we made some special exhaust form just to keep the cost down on that rather than doing one of our wonderful X pipes. So that was a little disappointing, but nonetheless, the guy was just through the moon happy with it. The sounds the car made, the performance it had, the boost response, the drivability, the guy just couldn't believe it. He really thoroughly enjoyed the car. He sent me some 0-60s and quarter miles on it that were really spectacular for a stock turbo car, you know, especially compared to a stock car. People just don't give the stock turbos enough credit for their capability, and they think it's always the turbo's fault, when actually it's everything else that's in the turbo's way. You just need to give the turbo all the air you can give it, let the air flow all the way through the intake system, and let it do its job. And those things will flow a tremendous amount of air and make for a whole lot of horsepower.
So does anyone really need a bigger turbo?
Maybe. Maybe in a specific racing class. Maybe if they're trying to set the record for the most horsepower on the dyno. Maybe if they're running extremely high-speed racing events. For the street, though, a lot of people just want more and more horsepower and end up getting caught in that loop of more, and they end up going slower than the other guy that's got a properly sized turbo. So need in some very specific instances, yes, but most of the time, no. Samantha, you may have been wondering what these are sitting in front of us the whole time. Yeah, they're turbos, but how can there be such a massive difference in turbochargers from this tiny, tiny little turbocharger to these massive turbochargers? And what's going on here is Austin is putting this on his go-kart. A tiny little single cylinder engine, a little RHB31. I forget what this thing made, but it was actually pretty impressive. I think this thing makes like 40 horsepower or something. And then you move over to these guys, and these are going to be the primary turbos on Austin and Andrew's diesel trucks. They've both got Dodge Diesels, and they're going to do compound turbos. And on a compound turbo system, you're going to take this massive amount of air and blow it out of that one. And no, it's not going into this one, but for example, it will come out of this one into the next turbo, and then from that turbo into the engine. And the same thing on the exhaust side. I'm not really into the diesel turbos, but these guys are, and they're having fun. And these things were just too fun not to show off. What do you think about these things?
It's pretty impressive. Doesn't look like it would fit in a Porsche.
Now that would be a challenge. 2,000, 2,500 horsepower worth of turbo right there. I think it might be next Tuesday before the boost came on, then maybe not real fun to drive. But impressive, impressive looking nonetheless.
Thanks for watching this video. If you have any questions regarding turbos or tuning or anything Porsche 911 related, here's your guy right here. So be sure to leave a like and a comment and subscribe to our channel so you don't miss our next video. See you next time.
Thanks for watching. What do you think happened?
I don't know.
I don't need to narrate that, don't I? Do I? Now I can't even talk.
Okay, so on any Porsche, can I just replace my turbo with a larger one?
911 covers a lot of years.
I didn't say 911.
What did you say?
I just said Porsche.
Well.